They seem to come out of the blue. The questions about Canada and China, political interference, and Chinese secret police.
Simple question. How many of Beijing's police stations are operating on Canadian soil today? How many?
When will the government close down all these Beijing-backed police stations in Canada?
Given our quid pro quo relationship with China, how could it all come as such a surprise? For years, China has had a national obsession with the hunt for corrupt government officials and the arrests of so-called economic criminals, as chronicled on TV shows in China like this one. Fugitives paraded in front of state media like trophies. And know it or not, Canada has increasingly become China's partner in that.
There's consistent evidence going back 20 years of the use of torture to force confessions.
And to keep Canada in that hunt, China has leveraged everything from trade.
I'm pleased that China has granted Canada approved destination status.
To hostages.
They wanted to sign an extradition treaty with Canada, and I kept telling them we won't sign one.
To the latest drug epidemic.
We're seeing powder form of fentanyl coming in from Asia.
And all the while, China was running secret police operations in Canada.
I certainly was aware of Chinese police officers acting in Canada and making threats against clients, for sure.
Now, for Canadians, the question is, at what cost?
She said, if the Chinese police find out that I talk to you, I'm dead.
I'm Bob McKeown, with season number 49 of The Fifth Estate. In 2015, China released a list of 100 international fugitives. 26 were believed to possibly be in Canada, including this man, Wang Qingwei, charged with alleged financial fraud. Chinese authorities tracked him down, and as part of their pressure campaign to force his return to China, they released his Canadian address, this mushroom farm in British Columbia. In December 2018, Wang Qingwei voluntarily returned to China to face the charges against him, seemingly a victory for the long arm of Chinese law enforcement. But as we'll show you, that was not the end of the story of Wang Qingwei and the Chinese police in Canada.
In our September report, Safeguard Defender says there were Chinese police operations around the world, including three in
Claims
Toronto.
Claims of criminal activity at so-called police stations allegedly set up by China's government.
Two new stations have been identified in Canada, bringing the total number to five.
The PRC uses clandestine means to coerce individuals overseas to return to China for persecution.
Last fall, a Spanish-based human rights group called Safeguard Defenders revealed the existence of those Chinese police stations in the Greater Toronto area, part of China's international network of clandestine outposts, reportedly set up to hunt down and return thousands of alleged fugitives.
Currently, we're looking at three of the police stations in Toronto and one in Vancouver.
The Chinese embassy claimed they weren't police stations, but government service outlets. The RCMP started an investigation, and Ottawa demanded an explanation from the Chinese ambassador. Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said he raised the matter with Chinese President Xi Jinping at the G20 meeting in Bali last November.
Honorable leader of the opposition.
What specific interference was the Prime Minister referring to when he raised his serious concerns about interference with the Chinese president?
Yeah. Honorable Prime Minister.
We've known for many years that there are consistent engagements by representatives of the Chinese government into Canadian communities with local media, reports of illicit Chinese police stations. These are all things that we continue to be concerned about.
I wouldn't call them secret Chinese police stations, but I certainly was aware of Chinese police officers acting in Canada, you know, and making threats against clients, for sure. So I knew that. So that didn't surprise me.
Lauren Waldman is a veteran Toronto immigration lawyer who represents alleged Chinese fugitives in Canada. He says what is inexplicable to him is why the Canadian government has kept cooperating with China.
So it seems to me that our economic interests sort of drove this so that we turned a blind eye to the lack of rule of law in China. We turned a blind eye to the fact that we should be way more skeptical about the evidence of coming from China. And as time went on, we turned a blind eye to the fact that Chinese agents were acting in Canada.
Canada's troubling collaboration to catch and return alleged Chinese fugitives has been rooted in a sweeping case of corruption in China that began more than two decades ago. It started in the bustling port city of Xiamen in China's Fujian province. In the late 1990s, two figures would emerge here whose impact on Canada-China relations is felt to this day. The first, Xi Jinping, one of the communist princelings from a well-connected family. He would become a party official himself, then rise to governor in Fujian province.
Xi Jinping, of course, is a Chinese blue blood, and his father was a very important senior official.
Another local boy named Lai Chansheng could not have been more different. Also raised in Fujian, but from modest roots, Lai would go on to make a massive fortune importing oil, cigarettes, and automobiles, known as the smuggling king.
Lai was a spectacularly successful fraudster. He'd started out in Fujian, known for its entrepreneurial energy that often bleeds into criminal activity.
In the 1990s, China was further adopting elements of the West's free market economy. Enterprising men like Lai got rich, as did Communist Party officials.
And this was the Wild West of China. This was that first decade when millions and millions of dollars are being made by officials at all levels. So what an ambitious official might be looking for is exactly a Lai Changsheng to be his generator of cash. So that's not to say that as soon as Lai was fingered, they wouldn't turn on him with vengeance, and they'd turn on him with even more enthusiasm because they'd want to get him out of the picture and shut him up.
When word of Lai's massive smuggling operation reached Beijing, China's central government formed a special unit to investigate Lai and his alleged corruption of public officials.
What Lai was accused of doing was to, in taking these goods from abroad without import duties and then sending them into the rest of China. And Lai, his attitude was, I mean, the government was on my side. I wasn't smuggling them into the rest of China. I was doing it with the cooperation of the government.
It was the biggest smuggling case involving a whole bunch of corrupted officials, including the mayors, the police chief, the head of the customs service.
Then, as the 21st century dawned, Chinese authorities shut down Lai's smuggling business, and scores of public officials were arrested. Lai's infamous home, known as the Red Mansion, was put on public display.
Under the gavel, millions of dollars worth of luxury items that once belonged to China's most wanted man.
And his bulletproof luxury car was auctioned off, too. But before Chinese law enforcement could nab Lai Changsheng himself, he fled China in 1999 and made his way to Canada.
He left mainland China a step ahead of the authorities, got himself to Hong Kong, got out of Hong Kong, and got himself into Canada. The Chinese never bothered to advise Canadian authorities that this is a person of interest, this is who they were after.
A year later, desperate to get Lai back, Chinese authorities deployed a now familiar strategy. They initiated a secret police operation in Canada. Three Chinese agents and Lai's brother entered the country on fraudulent visas to try to coerce Lai to return.
China pulled a fast one on Canada. they pretended to be this trade mission to get the visas, but what they were actually doing is trying to talk Lai into coming back to China with inducements, pressure, threats, whatever.
But that secret Chinese mission backfired. Instead of going back to China, Lai filed a refugee claim to stay in Canada.
This became public because, of course, Lai talked about it. And the government of Canada, in consequence, sent out a diplomatic note of protest of abusing the visa system for this purpose. And the Chinese government at that time expressed their regrets. They didn't say, we have every right to do this, and you shouldn't complain, and you're being anti-China, which is maybe what they'd say today.
Immigration Canada arrested Lai and his wife for their alleged crimes in China, and the RCMP investigated him for money laundering. And the Canadian government joined China in opposing Lai's refugee claim, endorsing questionable witness statements provided by the Chinese authorities.
This mountain of evidence, it stood about this high. Signed statements giving evidence against Lai Changxing by people who had been in detention.
In November 2001, Canadian lawyer Clive Ainslie had a law practice in Shanghai when he says he got a call from a former Lai employee. Her name was Tao Mi.
She said that, first of all, that she had only given this statement against Lai because she had been tortured by the Chinese police for 2 months first, and she had been detained in a hotel room until finally they told her that if you don't sign the affidavit that we've drafted for you, you'll never see your two-year-old child again.
Ainslie and his assistant took Tao Mi's statement that she was coerced into giving false evidence against Lai.
When she was in my office in Shanghai, she was... she was shaking like a leaf the whole time.
Ainslie promised her that her identity would be protected.
She came and told me she wanted to recant all the evidence that she had given earlier.
Time is 10:13.
But as you'll see, that was not how it would work. When we return, the Canadian government was about to knowingly expose Tao Mi to the brutality of Chinese authorities.
Do you know where she is?
No, I don't believe she's alive. I think she meant it quite literally when she said, if the Chinese police find out that I talk to you, I'm dead.
Quite well. We want to have a very close relation with China so that the trade between our two nations increase every year.
Jean Chrétien's high-profile trade missions to China were a feature of his era as prime minister. One of the largest markets in the world was open for business, and Canada wanted a piece of it. And no high-profile fugitive was going to get in the way. Lai Changxing was China's most wanted, the country's so-called smuggling king. He had fled China to avoid a likely death sentence and was now seeking refugee status in Canada. One of the Chinese government's witnesses against Lai was a 33-year-old woman named Tao Mi, who claimed she'd only testified against him after being tortured and threatened. Remember, lawyer Clive Ainslie believed Canadian justice would protect Tao Mi's identity, but that didn't happen.
I had discovered the betrayal by the Canadian government by being delivered a set of videotapes of several hours of interrogation of Tao Mi by an RCMP officer in the presence of a Chinese police officer on the premises of the Canadian Consulate General in Shanghai.
And what went through your mind when you saw those?
Outrage, fear for Tao Mi. I have to say, at the time, I felt ashamed to be a Canadian.
I am not attached to the Ministry of Public Security, and I'm not a Chinese police officer.
What Colin Walker was the RCMP liaison officer in China. But as soon as he gives assurance he's not working for the Chinese police, he's stopped. Chinese authorities are outside the room and they want to get in. It's a rare glimpse of high-stakes immigration law involving China.
The Ministry of Public Security have requested that one of their officers be present in the room during the taking of this videotape statement. Mm-hmm. Are you in agreement with one of their officers being present?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir, no
problem. But when the Chinese security officer sits in, she refuses to provide her name.
Is it necessary for me to say that?
Yes. Yes.
That's when Colin Walker of the RCMP stops the proceedings.
Okay. The time is 10:14, and this interview is terminated.
Eventually, the Chinese officer does identify herself. But at no time in her presence does Tao Mi say her original statement to Chinese authorities was coerced by torture or threats.
Do you recognize the statement? Did you provide the statement voluntarily?
Yes.
And are the statements, is the contents of the statement true?
Yes.
In the end, Lai's Canadian refugee claim was denied. The Immigration and Refugee Board ruled that Tao Mi was not tortured or abused, and that her RCMP interview was not said under duress. But later, reviewing that decision, a Canadian federal court judge called Tao Mi's interview with the Chinese officer present extraordinary, unfair, and unnecessary. But for Tao Mi herself, it was all too late.
When did you last see Tao Mi?
When she was in my office in December of 2001.
Do you know where she is?
No, I don't believe she's alive. I think she meant it quite literally when she said, if the Chinese police find out that I talk to you, I'm dead.
Now retired on Vancouver Island, lawyer Clive Ainslie has testified as a witness on China's legal system in dozens of fugitive cases. But more than 20 years later, the case of Tao Mi haunts him still.
She said, if the Chinese police ever find out that I talk to you, I'm dead. And she asked me about six times over, can I... can I depend on this undertaking?
In other words, that her identity will be protected.
And I laughed at her. And I said, the lawyers have given an undertaking. And I said, a Canadian lawyer who breaches an undertaking can be disbarred. And I said, you don't have to worry about the protection of the undertaking.
But evidently, neither the alleged torture and disappearance of a witness nor secret Chinese police operations in Canada would deter Canadian cooperation.
When I get evidence that comes from China and I see witness statements, my first thing is, how much weight can I give to a witness statement coming from someone who was probably tortured to give it?
There are people saying that all judges in China are corrupted, and all prosecutors are corrupted, and all police officers torture people.
Not true?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
There's no way to correct it.
China legal expert Vincent Yang spent years promoting judicial reform in China and has appeared as an expert witness for the Canadian government in Chinese fugitive cases, including the Lai case.
Everything has to be recorded. And in the trial, if the defense counsel raises an issue of torture, well, you get the tape, you know? So everything is recorded. That's a deterrence of torture.
No camera, please.
In a 2006 assessment of the risks Lai Chanqing might face should he return to China, Canadian immigration officials said he was unlikely to be at risk of torture. a conclusion deemed patently unreasonable by a federal court just a year later.
I remember speaking with the Chinese ambassador, and he said, David, we will never have a normal relationship. Things will not be the same until you return Lai Changxing. And I said, Ambassador, I'm sorry you believe that, but that's what we were, you know, this is a self-inflicted wound. There is a process that Lai has to go through. He entered Canada illegally. You knew his background and didn't share that with us. You sent a team in, you know, a clandestine team in to bring him out. So you have nobody but yourselves to blame for this.
In terms of the question of Mr. Lai, as you know, the government of Canada has been seeking his extradition.
When he became prime minister, Stephen Harper's conservative government would inherit the Lai case.
But I don't think Canadians want us to sell out important Canadian values, our belief in democracy, freedom, human rights. They don't want to sell that out to the almighty dollar.
Despite that tough talk, the protracted Lai case began to impact Canadian-Chinese trade relations. Specifically, China withheld from Canada the lucrative approved destination status that, in effect, prevented millions of Chinese tourists from visiting Canada, along with their money.
And I believe that the reason was specifically Lai Changxing. And so the idea was, we're not going to let our people go freely to Canada if Canada is so cavalier and careless and won't return any citizens who might have done wrong in China.
In 2009, the Harper government's ambassador, David Mulroney, and his team came up with a quid pro quo proposal. In return for approved status, Canada would begin discussions on sharing the proceeds of crime held by Chinese fugitives.
Clearly, the thing that rankled was the notion that Canada was holding on to the ill-gotten gains of someone that had been taken from the mouths of the babes of China.
So, Canada got what it wanted.
I'm pleased that China has granted Canada approved destination status. This could generate up to a 50% boost in tourism.
And China got what it wanted too. Both sides reaffirming their intention to strengthen cooperation, combating transnational crime, and repatriating fugitives. In other words, Canada was now all in on the hunt for China's most wanted. In 2011, more than a decade after he first arrived in Canada, Lai Changxing was sent to prison in China. His return was conditional on high-level Chinese assurances that Lai would not be tortured or put to death. Xi Jinping was a party official in Fujian province while Lai built his smuggling empire there. But by 2011, Xi had moved on to the big time. Now China's vice president, on track to becoming its next head of state.
Xi Jinping was in Fujian at the time Lai Changxing was operating in Fujian. And he was not only concerned about it, but also at one point reprimanded for letting it happen, even though it's not clear exactly what responsibility he bore for it. Maybe he learned maybe the wrong lesson from it, that the priority became under Xi Jinping. Rather than expand the economy, it became fighting corruption.
After the break, just how far was Canada willing to go to keep China happy?
My understanding was to facilitate an interview that would allow for a conversation to see if the Chinese fugitive, the person of interest, would voluntarily return back to China.
In 2012, Xi Jinping ascended to the position of General Secretary of the Communist Party of China. 5 months later, he became China's president. And China's fugitive hunt went into overdrive. Security operatives fanning out around the globe in pursuit of alleged corrupt officials and economic criminals. And Canada seemed only too eager to help.
There was a strong desire to and direction given to collaborate and cooperate. And that was coming at that time from the federal government.
Calvin Krusty is a former senior RCMP operations officer in British Columbia. Chinese organized crime, from drug trafficking to money laundering, had always been on his radar. But he was wary of the political push to cooperate with Chinese security officials and finding alleged fugitives.
There was some complexities to these cases that many Canadians, including police, probably didn't have a good understanding of.
Krusty told us how he was directly tasked to reach out to a Chinese fugitive in Canada, which he refused.
Senior officials in Ottawa had requested that I facilitate a meeting between a delegation of Chinese security and intelligence officials and a fugitive that was residing in Canada. My understanding was to facilitate an interview that would allow for a conversation to see if the Chinese fugitive, the person of interest, would voluntarily return back to China.
I thought it's totally unacceptable if they did that.
Stop Xi Jinping from killing people!
Stop Xi Jinping from killing people!
Mabel Tung is a longtime China democracy activist in Vancouver, who's witnessed up close how Chinese authorities target dissidents.
We have to protect Canadian sovereignty and safeguarding democracy.
I don't think it's right for them to call the individual on behalf of the Chinese government.
Why do you think they did?
I didn't know why they did it.
To monitor and to control the views and opinions of the Chinese living in this country.
Canada should cooperate with our allies in terms of assisting them in repatriating fugitives who are genuinely fugitives from justice. But we should be careful before we do that in terms of being satisfied that, you know, the allegations are credible and have some foundation.
But RCMP brass and politicians in Ottawa apparently did not share those concerns. In the years that followed, law enforcement cooperation with China would be more formalized. By 2015, China's anti-corruption campaigns targeting alleged fugitives were being branded as Skynet and Fox Hunt.
After Xi Jinping came to power, you know, he launched this Fox Hunt campaign trying to repatriate economic fugitives, and this was part of his whole anti-corruption campaign. But, you know, since then, I've learned that, in fact, it's a their activities are a lot more extensive than what I would have suspected.
Guy Saint-Jacques succeeded David Mulroney as Canada's ambassador to China. He revealed to us for the first time how Canada agreed to cooperate with the Chinese in an effort to stop their clandestine activities.
We knew that there were probably some inspectors coming unannounced on a visitor's visa, supposedly for doing tourism. And those people are more difficult to identify. And so, in a way, we said, well, if we organize this and it's controlled, in a way, it will be easier to manage.
As Ambassador Saint-Jacques watched, that Chinese hunt became ever more aggressive, increasing pressure on Canada to cooperate. In 2014, Chinese authorities arrested Canadian missionaries and cafe owners Julia and Kevin Garrett. Julia Garrett would be released after 6 months, then put under house arrest. Her husband would remain in a Chinese prison for 2 years.
We've been working diligently with Chinese officials on this.
Saint-Jacques says China made Garrett's release conditional, in part on negotiating an extradition treaty with Canada. In other words, making it easier to repatriate fugitives to China.
It was a clear case of a hostage taking. And they wanted to sign an extradition treaty with Canada. And I kept telling them, we won't sign one.
But lawyer Lauren Waldman believes that Canada has used the immigration system as a kind of backdoor to remove Chinese fugitives and avoid extradition cases which would never stand up in a Canadian court.
Why is it that we're not prepared to extradite someone back to China? And it's because no I don't believe a Superior Court judge would ever authorize an extradition back to China, given the state of the rule of law there. So if that's the case, and we're not prepared to extradite, and we've never extradited, why are we deporting people back to China based on evidence that we know is not reliable?
But hostages weren't the only leverage that China used to press its agenda.
We're seeing a powder form of fentanyl coming in from Asia.
Canada was now being flooded with a new deadly synthetic opioid. Up to 50 times more potent than heroin, fentanyl was addicting and killing Canadians like no drug before, much of it coming from China.
The fentanyl crisis hit Vancouver. Vancouver was a ground zero for North America.
Our RCMP liaison officers in Beijing had a hard time to get the Chinese to collaborate with them to try to stop the or reduce the, those shipments. And the Chinese kept saying, well, on our side, we would like you to collaborate more to help us to repatriate economic fugitives. And so at some point, you know, we had a discussion at the embassy and we said, well, let's make a recommendation to Ottawa that we will offer more collaboration on what they want, and in exchange, we will get more of what we want.
The bottom line was that in return for their assistance in curbing the fentanyl epidemic, the Chinese wanted the RCMP to help convince fugitives to voluntarily return to China.
And so a memorandum of understanding was signed between the RCMP and the Ministry of Public Security, saying visits of Chinese inspectors will be allowed to Canada, but they will have to tell us in advance who they want to meet with, and every detail of the program will have to be agreed upon.
Again, I maintain my, years later, that reservation to participate with a country like that, like a foreign state that had the reputation that it had, unless I had a lot more clarity and visibility as to what was going on, which I didn't, and I don't think anybody did.
Indeed, former Ambassador Saint-Jacques recalls a Canadian visit by Chinese investigators in 2016, and the subsequent briefing he got from Canada's spy agency, CSIS.
The CSIS liaison officer at the embassy came to see me and he said, Mr. Ambassador, I have to report that we caught some members of the Chinese delegation doing extracurricular activities. And I said, okay, just give me enough ammunition so that I can meet them and challenge them.
Saint-Jacques says he confronted a Chinese vice minister with evidence that they had met with people in Canada outside the letter and spirit of their agreement.
And so I told this vice minister, I said, let me warn you, if this happens again, it's the end of the collaboration. And he said it will never happen again.
But once again, it seems Canada had decided to give China a pass for its bad behavior.
Maybe we were a bit naive was to think that, in fact, we could control their activities in Canada, because we were afraid that there were already visits taking place.
After nearly two decades of increasing law enforcement cooperation, the West's view of China's hunt for fugitives was about to take a turn.
Now, China describes Fox Hunt as some kind of international anti-corruption campaign. It is not. Instead, Fox Hunt is a sweeping bid by General Secretary Xi to target Chinese nationals whom he sees as threats.
When we come back, how Chinese agents pressured one fugitive in Canada to turn himself in, and later, how he allegedly was used in a secret Chinese police operation. In 2015, Chinese authorities put an unlikely name on their list of international fugitives. Wang Qingwei was a British Columbia mushroom farmer accused of financial fraud in China. As part of their campaign to pressure Wang to return to China, the Chinese made public his Canadian address. This farm, about an hour from Vancouver. And the strategy seemed to work. In 2018, Wang Qingwei voluntarily returned to be prosecuted in China. Toronto immigration lawyer Lauren Waldman is familiar with the technique.
Pressure in China, pressure against the individuals here, pressure against other individuals in Canada that could put pressure on them, publicizing them and embarrassing them and putting pressure on them through the Chinese media. All of those things have happened.
But there would be no show trial for Wang Qingwei. His arrest was the last that the Canadian or Chinese public would hear of him.
Good afternoon. I'm joined.
Then, in October 2022, there was this.
In the Eastern District of New York, the Justice Department charged seven individuals who are working on behalf of the PRC.
The U.S. Department of Justice alleged those seven secret agents were taking orders from the Chinese government to lure a wanted fugitive back to China.
The indictment alleges that the defendants, working at the direction of the government of the PRC, engaged in a campaign of harassment, threats, surveillance, and intimidation aimed at coercing the victim to return to China.
But the U.S. indictment also mentions someone else, identified as the Canadian victim. There's no name attached, but according to legal papers filed in the U.S., there's mention of a recorded phone call in which that Canadian victim said that when he returned to China in 2018, he received an adjudication of guilt without punishment. He was neither detained nor mistreated. And when he returned to Canada after the verdict, the case was closed. And no one subsequently bothered him. In other words, it was an outcome that might well convince others to turn themselves in.
So who is that so-called Canadian victim identified in the legal fine print of that American indictment? Well, we're on our way to meet him now. At least, we hope.
You may have deduced that the person we've come to see, formerly wanted by the Chinese government for financial fraud, is in fact mushroom farmer Wang Qingwei of British Columbia.
Should we go say hi?
Yeah.
We find Wang out back in a shed. He declines to be interviewed, leaving unanswered questions. Was he found guilty in China and then allowed to return to Canada? He tells us only that his legal matter was political and that it's now all sorted out. But is he being used by Chinese authorities to convince other fugitives to return? He recalls that phone call with the U.S. target, but claims no knowledge of any American indictment. The Canada Border Services Agency declined to comment for us on Wang's case.
China's United Fund Work Department.
But democracy activist Mabel Tung of Vancouver believes the Canadian government now is finally motivated to tackle Chinese interference in Canada.
They understand China better than 10 years ago.
Yeah.
They definitely have another way of dealing with China and not really just emphasize on trade
yeah.
and relations.
Do you see things substantially changing?
In my work, no. That's what I'm finding so surprising.
Despite wide-ranging allegations of foreign interference, and after the sting of China's arbitrary detention of the two Michaels, incredibly, Lauren Waldman says Canada's federal government is still, even today, cooperating with China to return fugitives.
Just to be clear, you're saying that despite all that you've described, and despite all that we've seen in the headlines, that Canadian authorities are still taking evidence at face value from Chinese authorities.
Yes.
And using it as a basis to repatriate alleged or suspected Chinese fugitives.
That's right. Absolutely. There's no question. It's pretty hard to understand.
Even harder to understand is what Waldman reveals next. That at the same time Immigration Canada and the Canada Border Services Agency are trying to send his fugitive clients back to China, CSIS, Canada's spy agency, has interviewed those same clients to learn how Chinese agents are harassing or coercing them and their families.
CSIS interviewed either relatives of clients or clients directly, asking them if they have been threatened or harassed by Chinese agents in China. And some of these were people that CBSA was actively trying to send back to China.
It's now been 12 years since Canada returned China's most wanted man. Lai Chan-Ching is still locked in a Chinese prison. And under the terms of his return, Canada still has a duty of care.
I mean, he's still not happy with the way he's being treated in prison, and so it's a continuing issue about whether or not the assurances are being respected. That's where he is now.
He complains that he's not being given medical
help. Yes, that's
help,
true.
That's true. Torture of its own kind.
Yes, yeah, so there is a continuing issue.
These days, Chinese President Xi Jinping doesn't beat the anti-corruption drum as loudly as he once did.
Foreign interference in Canadian democratic institutions is unacceptable.
And after months of waffling by the Trudeau government, this summer, Public Safety Minister Dominic Leblanc finally announced a public inquiry into foreign interference. But it is unclear how deep that inquiry will go into Canada's 20-year quid pro quo relationship with China, which set the scene for this current reckoning. The minister and the Mounties both declined to speak with us for this story. And the Chinese embassy in Ottawa did not respond to our request for an interview.
No Chinese government party!
China liars!
China liars!
Canadians opened their eyes, finally realized that a lot of infiltration that we thought is normal, we normalized the abnormal, right?
Everything we discuss is then leaked to the paper. That's not appropriate.
When they met in Bali last November, the Chinese president was seen to scold the Canadian prime minister.
I continue to look to work constructively together, but there will be things we will disagree on.
What lessons have since been learned still remain to be seen.
We've got to make it difficult and cause enough of a furor that China will at least back off for a time and see us as another difficult nut to crack. But we're not exactly giving off the vibe of a country that's bristling with aggression and unwilling to be interfered with. And as long as that's the case, we're going to be interfered with.